wait till we have this room, that room, and that back room all filled at one time. Well, okay, I'm a visionary, I guess. Optimistic type person. I'm going to read you a statement. The world redeemer came not only to be a sacrifice for sin, but to be an example to man and all, a holy human character. Do you ever get tired of hearing about Jesus?
No.
You know, I cannot speak enough about our Lord. Every time I open that Bible, I see his examples. I see his leadings, his promptings. I see the Holy Spirit guiding and growing our minds. You know, it's just exciting to me. Sometime the other day, I got so excited. I got my wife in a room, and I started showing her stuff. Can you see this? And she said, no. I said, I feel like I found the Holy Grail. And she says, you know, I can see just a little glimpse, Houston. So it's very beautiful what the Lord is doing in our lives. All we have to do is stay focused on Jesus Christ and continue to follow. The things he pours out to us is just amazing. Amazing. The fall of our first parents broke the golden chain of implicit obedience of the human will to the divine. Obedience has no longer been deemed an absolute necessity. The human agents follow their own imaginations, which the Lord said of the inhabitants of the old world were evil, and that continually. The Lord Jesus declares, I have kept my Father's commandments. How? As a man, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. To the accusations of the Jews, he stood forth in his pure, virtuous, holy character and challenged them. Which of you convinceth me of sin? The world's Redeemer came not only to be a sacrifice for sin, but to be an example to man in all, a holy human character. He was a teacher, such an educator as the world never saw or heard before. He spake as one having authority, and yet he, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. Let us pray. Holy Father, I ask that you be here today. Let your divine presence fill this room. Let your holy angels come and sit among us. Let your words be heard, broaden our minds, guide our hearts, take up the reins of the will of each one's mind, including mine. Let your words only be heard and remove self from your sermon. In Yahushua's holy name, in Jesus' holy name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
You know, did Jesus, when he came, I'm going to ask y'all something. Did he come as a mini God to serve a greater God?
No.
It wasn't a lesser God becoming obedient to a greater God. It was a man showing us he came as a man. And he came with all the... See, if he had come as anything more, Satan would have used it against him. He would have declared that Jesus has conquered all this stuff because of his divine powers. That's not how Jesus came. What the Lord revealed to me a couple of weeks ago was just simply amazing. I'm sitting there and I'm looking at some drawings I have, and some schematics and some layouts, and all of a sudden I begin to see the footprints of my Lord. I begin to see the footprints of Christ. And that walk that he was walking was, he was walking the footprints of Adam, and he was walking backwards, descending and going backwards back into the Garden of Eden, undoing everything that original sin had created by our parents' fall. And this is what I begin to see. And I said, oh, I have to share this with everybody. And it's very beautiful. Turn with me to Genesis. Let's go back and look at original sin. Is about the fall of man. If we read this chapter, we find that this is where Adam and Eve actually fell to sin. Now I want to go back and read a little bit of this. Start with, I want to ask y'all a question. Did Adam and Eve have any commandments in the Garden of Eden?
Yes.
I had a man argue with me one time. He said, there was no commandments in the garden. There was no Ten Commandments at the Garden of Eden. Yes. And I said, because the Bible doesn't say it. Strictly and plainly. It does not say there was the Ten Commandments, even though we know today that's God's throne. But what does the Bible say? Right here, Genesis 2:17. Go back to 2:17. Let me show you. I told the guy, I said, oh yeah, they had commandments. I said, as a matter of fact, that's why they fell to Satan, because they broke God's commandment. Right here in verse 17. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest, therefore, thereof, thou shalt surely die. There's the commandment. God said, I've given you all of this in this garden. He says, but this one tree in the center, it was to show and to prove God, man's loyalty to God. He said, don't eat of this one tree. Don't eat it. But what happens? In chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree in the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. Wait a minute. Did Eve add to God's words here?
Yes.
Yes, she did. She added a little extra. And Satan took that little bit and he moved in to create her destruction, which led to the fall of Adam. So she added to God's word. God said, don't eat of it. He never said, don't touch the fruit. Don't tend to it. He says, don't eat it. But then when she's beguiled by the serpent, by the fallen angel, she adds this to it. Well, Satan come in, and I'm just going to sum this up. You have chapter 3 here. You can go back and read it. What happens is Satan attacks us three ways. And right here, you'll see that. Well, let's go ahead and read it. I want to go ahead and share this with you. And the serpent saith unto the woman, ye shall not surely die, for God doth know that in the day that ye eat thereof, your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, when she what?
Saw
that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree is to be desired to make one wise, she took the fruit thereof and did eat. There you go. We have right here the three temptations that Satan attacks you by. All right, it's the lust and the passions through all of us. Or do y'all have lusts? Are any of us in here without lusts? No. Are any of us in here without passions? No. That's our weaknesses. And that's how Satan attacks us, through the appetite of these things. See, he comes in to kill, steal, and destroy you through your, here it is, lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, pride of life. And all three things are right here. She saw the fruit. It was good for food. She lusted after it, lust of the flesh. Then she saw it, lust of the eyes. I can just imagine this serpent who had wings of golden, this beautiful serpent, taking the fruit off the tree after she said, and the Lord said, we shall not touch it. And he's biting into it. And he grabs another one and he throws it at her. And she catches it and he says, see, you didn't die. Could that be? It could happen. It could have happened this way. Bible doesn't tell us this. But she touched it, she didn't die, so that led to the next step, right? Let me taste it. It looks good. It's good for food. And then the last thing is lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. I want y'all to keep these in mind, because this is how Satan attacks. After the fall, and y'all know the story, I'm not going to go into all the details. God comes to the garden looking for him. Adam, where are you? Did he know where he was?
Sure.
Sure he did. Testing. He says, who told you you were naked? Did God know they were naked beforehand? Did he know they'd already sewed fig leaves and tried to cover themselves? He knew all these things. Where was the first sacrifice? Right here in the Garden of Eden. Right here. You look at verse 3:21. Unto Adam also and to his wife did the Lord God make coats of skins and clothed them. Where did the skins come from? He
killed an animal.
What kind of animal did he slay?
He slayed
a lamb. Already we have the picture forming. Jesus had already accepted and stepped up and said he would be our sacrifice and stand in our place. And the sacrificial system began right here. And God took them out of the garden because they now know good and evil, lest they take of the tree of life and live forever. That's the lie that Satan would have you believe, that you can overtake the kingdom of heaven without Christ and live forever in the last days if you're on the wicked side of the wicked. I don't plan to be in the smoking section. I don't know about y'all.
Amen.
I don't want to be on that section. Can't stand smoke. So, now we have the life of Christ. Christ comes as a baby. I know all the prophecies are being fulfilled. They flee to Egypt. They come back. What does he do at the beginning of his ministry?
Baptized.
Now we're going to walk in the footsteps of Christ. And what you're going to see is the title of the sermon, The Undoing of a Curse. He came to undo that curse. And he begins to walk. What does Jesus tell us? Walk as I walk. Follow me. Take up your cross. All these things. It's the undoing of the curse. Turn with me to Matthew 3:13. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to the Jordan unto John. What river did the Israelites cross to get into the promised land?
Jordan.
What river?
No.
Jordan.
Red Sea.
It's all right. Sorry. Yeah, that's a good form of baptism. All right, Jordan River. All right, so now let me ask y'all something. Christ is coming to the Jordan River right here to be baptized by who?
John
the Baptist. Why is Jesus being baptized?
Fulfill the scripture.
Fulfill all righteousness. Right? That's what he tells John. John shrinks down and says, no, Lord, I have need to be baptized of thee. And what does Jesus say? He says, even so, let it be. Baptize me that all righteousness shall be fulfilled. What exactly does that mean? He's setting an example. You know what he's doing? He's opening up the spiritual kingdom to you and I. He has associated himself and related himself to us. Jesus had no sin. He didn't have to be baptized to wipe away sin at all. Christ made baptism the entrance of his spiritual kingdom. He made this a positive condition with which all must comply who wish to be acknowledged as under the authority of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All those who would accept Christ would go to baptism with him in death. You know, how many of us get buried alive in the waters? That's a big question. There's a lot of people buried alive. You know why they're buried alive? They did not go to death with Christ. That's something to think about. Christ had no sin, and when he went to that baptism, he associated himself with humanity, and he opened up the spiritual kingdom to us. It's the first step, the footstep of Christ. He is walking back into the garden. And then he comes out of the baptism of John. Y'all have the Bible here in front of you. We have the chapter right here. You can go home and read these. But he goes up on the bank, he lays down and begins to pray. The most beautiful prayer. And the Father himself speaks as the Holy Spirit descends upon Christ. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. So what does Christ do when he gets up from here? Well, he begins his walk. Where is he walking to?
Wilderness.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you like this. The Garden of Evil. He's going back into the Garden of Evil. And this wilderness is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. He is going back to the tree that our fathers fell from. To face the foe, the adversary, again. Except this go around is not a luscious, beautiful, full of fruit garden. It's the wilderness with all of its curse, all of its demons, with the great adversary, the fallen angel himself, pursuing Christ and tempting him. He spent 6 weeks there. 6 weeks in that wilderness. Let's go to this. Turn with me to one chapter over, Matthew chapter 4. Am I going too fast for you? Now it was time, after his baptism, that the Lord rose up. By the way, there's a lot more I can share about baptism, and I plan to share on this in the future. But I'm only concentrating right now on this curse that he is undoing in his walk. Do you see a pattern starting to form here? Now he's walking from the water of life that he associated himself with us through. And he's walking back to that tree of knowledge of good and evil. Except this time, it's 100 times worse than any of us would ever experience. We could never experience what he went through. He experienced all of this weight of the curse. Totally. With nothing. Adam and Eve had everything. Think about that. Satan had already claimed control of this. As a matter of fact, he at this time was in total control of this planet. So let's go here and read the temptations. Now it was time that our Lord walked toward the tree of knowledge of good and evil once again and faced the adversary. Christ would begin his walk backward from the original sin in the Garden of Eden. But first he must pass through the Garden of Evil. These are my words. His mission had begun, and he would undo all that our first parents had caused all of us, humanity, to fall by, which is their own actions without weighing the consequences. Adam never weighed the consequences of what he was doing. Totally. So here Jesus is, going back out, Matthew 4, verse 1. Then Jesus, led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God. First of all, he came trying to tempt Jesus into believing that he wasn't the Son of God. You're not the Son of God. But if you are the Son of God, that's how tricky he is. If you are, prove it. And that's what he's trying to get Christ to do here. And Christ will prove it as time goes along. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. What is he attacking? He's attacking your intellect. He's attacking, right there, he attacks our intellects through the lust of the flesh. Through our own lust of our flesh. Appetite. Paul says the stomach and the use thereof will perish. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. So he defends himself with writings from Moses, the Word of God. He goes back to the Word of God, and he says, and he never said, I'm the Son of God. Let me prove it to you. Did he do that?
No.
Was there any pride there?
No.
No, he was lowly and meek. And he says, follow me. Follow me. Then the devil taketh him up into a holy city and setteth him on a pinnacle of the temple. And saith unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee. Right there, Satan acknowledges that he could be the Son of God. And in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest thou dash thy foot upon a stone. And Jesus said unto him again, it is written. What is this that he's attacking now? He's attacking his will. Pride of life. Do you see him at the garden again in front of this tree with the serpent? Doing battle? The second Adam? Isn't that a picture to be formed? He's back in front of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil with the whole curse of the world on top of his shoulders. In the evil garden. Ruled by the prince of this world at that time. And here he is. Satan's attacking his will now. Through pride of life. Did Jesus express any pride? Or did he stay faithful to the Father? He stayed faithful. Jesus said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Submit the will. God wants us in our humanity to worship, honor, and follow Him. We're not angels. We don't have no special powers. It's in our humanity that He desires our worship the way we are. Come to Him the way you are. So here, our Savior is face to face with the serpent at the tree again. So what was the third temptation? Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And he saith unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. And Jesus saith unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written. Stop right here. What did he attack? So we've got an attack on the pride of life. We have an attack on the lust of the flesh. Now, he's attacking the, you see the backward walk? Lust of the flesh, pride of life. What's the last one? Lust of the eyes. Remember? The very first thing that Eve fell to. It looked good. It looked good. And she'd be bowed down. She bowed down and worshiped the serpent. And here Christ is with the adversary at the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Get thee hence behind me, Satan. For it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God. In him only shalt thou worship. Do you see him faking the curse? And unraveling what had been done here. But it's more. It goes on. We have to conquer. And Jesus did conquer the sin through its lust and passions, undoing the curse. Let me ask you something. Can we do the same? Can we conquer the same things?
Yes.
Yes. You know why I say that? Because Jesus didn't come as a lesser God. He came as a man. And he showed us how to walk. We don't need to go back to Israel and walk in his footsteps You have his footsteps right here.
Amen.
Right here. We just need to concentrate on our Savior and see how he walked. And walk with him. That's what he wants. Walk with me. I'm undoing it. Baptism, death, get up, go back. Conquer these lusts by his strength and power. Isn't that reassuring?
Amen.
Then we have the Garden of Gethsemane. That's very fitting. Now he's back in the garden. And he's been in front of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And he's walked back into the garden of disobedience. Didn't Adam and Eve sin in their disobedience?
Yes.
Now he's back there now. Here he is. He has that cup placed before him. Will you drink of it? Every time he says, Father, if it be your will, remove this cup from before me. But not my will, your will be done. Excuse me. So here he is, back in the garden, submitting totally. Is the curse of sin weighing heavily upon him at this time?
Yes.
It is. He's beginning to sweat great drops of blood. So here he is submitting the will. From here, our Savior takes us back into the garden to show complete obedience to the Father in heaven. How many of y'all can drink of that cup? Remember all the disciples sitting around arguing about who was going to be the greatest? And John and James's mother comes to Christ and she says, Lord, I will, would you please let my two sons sit on your right and your left? And he says to them, can you drink of the cup I'm going to drink? And be baptized with the baptism that I will be baptized with. And what were their response? Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. They had no clue what they were saying at that time. The Garden of Eden with its foul blood of disobedience is to be carefully studied and compared with the Garden of Gethsemane, where the world's Redeemer suffered superhuman agony when the sins of this whole world were rolled upon him. If we turn to Matthew 26. And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be sorrowful even and very heavy. Then saith he unto them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Tarry here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from before me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt. So what does he tell his disciples to do?
Watch.
He tells them to pray. Watch and pray. And then he goes out a little ways. Now here we are, Adam and Eve, together again. Do y'all see the picture? Where they separated a little distance. Why did Eve fall in the garden? She was separated a little distance from her husband. What were the disciples doing when he came back?
Sleeping.
They were sleeping. What? Can't you watch and pray with me? 1 hour? Here is Eve again. There's a little distance between them. Except Jesus came back to undo what had taken place. And he's going to conquer it this time. Do you think Adam was tormented when he realized Eve had eaten of the fruit? Yes. They were under the curse of the sin. Jesus is becoming a curse for us to undo what our parents had done. Isn't that something? And he cometh unto the disciples and findeth them asleep, and saith unto Peter, What could ye not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that ye enter not into what?
Temptation.
Watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. So here it is, second Adam, separated a little distance from Eve. And what does he tell his bride? He says, watch and pray that you don't enter into temptation. Our hearts are evil. We're born under the curse of sin. You know how you escape temptations and trials? Watch and pray. He's given us our instructions. Be in constant communication with Christ and the Father. What verse are we at? 42. He went away again a second time and prayed, Oh, my Father, if this cup may not pass away from me except I drink it, thy will be done. Is he submitting total will to the Father?
Yes.
Did Adam and Eve submit total will to the Father?
No.
No, they failed. Jesus is unraveling the curse. And he's doing it under great torment. Do you know the demons were piled in that Garden of Gethsemane there with him? And they were bearing down on him. And it's to a point that he began to sweat great drops of blood. Then a third time. How many temptations did he fall at? How many ways does he tempt us? 3 different ways. It's through your intellect, your will, and your pride of life. Jesus is conquering in battle the serpent and Satan right here. Isn't this a beautiful picture? Gives us a different look at what is happening here. But the third time, what does he do? As he has this sweat of blood on his brow and he begins to take on lost humanity. He could have easily wiped the sweat off his brow and got up and said, I can't do it. But he didn't. He had compassion for us. And what does he do? In his trembling hands, he takes up that cup and he drinks it. He takes it and drinks it. So here we are in a different garden setting. We're not in the same rich, full, beautiful, luscious garden that Adam and Eve was in. We're in the garden of evil. The garden of sin. Jesus is walking us backwards out of death. You're all captive to the chambers of this earth under Satan unless you accept Christ. We are then captives. We have to accept Him. Walk as He walked. Follow Him. Stay with His leadings. So then, this brings me back to our scripture reading, which was Numbers 21, I believe. Numbers 21, 7 and 9. Let's go there. Therefore, the people came to Moses and said, We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said unto Moses, Make thee a fiery serpent, and set it up on a pole. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made the serpent of brass, and put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. The Israelites sinned against God. And they spoke against the Lord. In their disobedience, God allowed these poisonous serpents to come into the camp. And many died. Do many die today? Do they die from the poison of the serpent?
Yes.
Yes. Unless we look upon the serpent, the symbol of the serpent on the cross. Jesus took on that curse and he walked it straight back into the earth, into the pits of hell, and he left it there and came out and brought many captive out with him. Those captive that were laying in the graves, they slept in the hope of their Redeemer. And he brought them out with him as an example of what's going to come at the last day. Turn with me to Galatians 3, 3:13. Galatians, Ephesians 3, 13 and 14. Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law. What has he redeemed us from? The curse of the law. Being made a curse for us. Was he made a curse for us?
Yes.
Bible says it right here. Was he made that brass serpent and placed it on a pole?
Yes.
For us to look upon, that we can escape the poison of the fiery serpent? Yes. Yes. Cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. Are we Gentiles?
Yes.
That we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Beautiful words. Turn with me to John 3:14. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Well, there you have it. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So he became a curse. He was as the serpent raised up before us. That if we look upon him who God had gave to us, that we could be saved from the poison. Turn with me to Matthew 16. Matthew 16:24. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself. What is the greatest denial ever in this whole universe? Yeah, I'm going to share it with you. God gave his Son. He had exalted his Son to be equal with himself before his Son ever came to this earth. It's in the book of Hebrews. It talks about how Christ was exalted and made equal with the Father. So he is in fact God in this aspect. God denied himself on the cross. Jesus is not the Father. The Father is not Jesus. God denied himself. That's the greatest denial that ever took place in our world. Then Jesus said unto his disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. And whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. I guess my question is, are we going to walk in the footprints of our Savior? That is that's a strong commitment. So when you go to baptism, receiving Christ and accepting Him in the authority of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the three great dignitaries and persons in the universe, you're accepting Christ and you're going to death with Christ. And then when you come up, follow His footsteps and walk yourself out from underneath this curse, clinging to your Savior. Amen. Let us pray. Holy Father, I give praise and thanks to you for this Sabbath day. I thank you for all that you reveal to us in your beautiful Son. We can never get enough of the knowledge of what He has done in the plan of salvation. I ask that you continue to lead us, guide us and direct us, guide our minds, plant our feet securely upon the foundation of eternal truth. And let us be found in Christ and enter into eternity with Him and yourself.